Hi everyone, welcome back to our lecture series. Today we will be talking about chapter 7. This will be the first part of the chapter 7. Still talking about the behavior of proteins. In this case, we'll be talking about, again, enzymes. We'll be talking about their mechanisms and we'll be talking about their controls as well. So this is what we're going to be talking about. So we've been talking about enzymes since chapter 6. So that is what we're going to continue here as well. Alright, let's take it off from there immediately. What are allosteric enzymes? Allosteric enzymes, okay, before I talk about allosteric enzymes, let's talk about allosteric. The term allosteric is derived from the Greek word. You know, most of these, a lot of Greek has a lot of origin in what the thing we did in science because the Greek had civilization of modern science quite early too. So, it is a Greek word that means other shape. Other shape, that's what it means. So allosteric enzymes are those enzymes that have just more than one site. One of the sites will be the active site where the substrate will bind. The other site is where the activators or inhibitors are going to bind. And what matters in this case is that, now, because most of them are exist as oligomers because they have more than one subunit. Now, the biological activity of one subunit is affected or changed by the binding of something. It could be a substrate, it could be an activator, it could be an inhibitor. So an allosteric enzyme is an oligomer whose biological activity is affected by substances binding to it. If a substance binds on another site and affects the activity on the another subunit, we now say that particular protein is an allosteric protein. So substances that change the enzyme's activity by altering their conformation particularly is in the quaternary structure. So just remember is that the conformation they change now is the quaternary structure. So what is an allosteric effector in this case? An allosteric effector is any substance that modifies the behavior of an allosteric enzyme. Now, this effector can be, like I said earlier, I already used those words. It may be an allosteric inhibitor, an allosteric activator. An inhibitor is the one that slows down the rate. An activator is the one that promotes or facilitates the rate of that reaction. A very good example of an allosteric enzyme we're going to be talking about in trying to use its process as an example is the aspartate transcarbamoylase. Aspartate transcarbamoylase is actually called in short ATKase. It's an allosteric protein that also involved in what we call the feedback inhibition. A feedback inhibition is like giving a feedback on what is going on. That's what I mean. A feedback means, you know, if you get to the end product and you have a lot of the end product will go and give a signal to the early reaction and say, okay, do not produce more. We're okay until we run out of what the product is. All right. So both ATKase and hemoglobin that we talked about exhibit cooperative activity. I told you what is cooperativity. A cooperative activity is that ability of oligomeric enzymes or allosteric enzymes to do what? To cooperate. What does the cooperation mean? If an activator or an inhibitor binds in one subunit, that subunit will activate the other subunit. That subunit will activate. So it's a kind of chain reaction. So if you have, if you have four subunits, what happens? There is a binding of, let's say, A to this subunit. This will trigger this one to also bind another stuff, maybe bind another A. This will trigger trigger this one. So this is positive activation. Will trigger this one again to bind another A. And this will trigger another one to bind another A. And at the end of the day, the action will be enhanced. So this is what we call cooperativity. So I usually tell my student, cooperation means when two people work together to achieve something. So these various subunits work together to achieve either the catalytic goal or any biological process in which they want to undergo. So allosteric enzymes have different responses in the presence of inhibitor from that of non-allosteric enzyme. We're going to illustrate this here. You remember we said it earlier. In the last lecture, we talked about in the last chapter, rather, in chapter 6, I know I had two parts of the lecture, we talked about they make a Michaelis-Menten model of the enzyme. And remember, when we plotted the graph, we told you that the graph of Michaelis-Menten enzyme will give you a hyperbola. This is a hyperbola when velocity is plotted against substrate concentration. Now, this hyperbola is a case of MM. I call it Michaelis-Menten behavior of the enzyme. Now, this only happens where those enzymes have only one subunit. So we will describe this as what? Non-allosteric behavior. Those enzymes that are not allosteric, because they only have one subunit in them. However, if an enzyme is an allosteric enzyme and undergoes cooperativity, you know, remember this is, I tried to illustrate my cooperativity. I didn't write that. I'm going to write it. If an enzyme is an allosteric enzyme and all allosteric enzymes, because they have more than one unit, they're going to cooperate, they undergo cooperativity. When you plot the graph of velocity times substrate concentration, you're going to be getting a sigmoid curve. This is a sigmoid. Sigmoid curve. This is a sigmoid curve. So this sigmoid curve is a characteristic of what? The allosteric enzymes. It shows cooperativity of these enzymes. And in fact, if you introduce an inhibitor, most inhibitors will push, most inhibitors will push, if you add an inhibitor here now, an inhibitor is going to push this towards this direction. This means plus inhibitor. What it does is that inhibitor is reducing the binding, because this is substrate concentration now, so you're making it more free. It's reducing the binding of the substrate to the enzyme. And when you add, okay, let me use another color. And when you add an activator is going to move it towards this direction. This is plus activator. Okay. Plus activator A. An activator will move it backwards, an inhibitor will move it forward. So this is actually the cooperative behavior of allosteric enzyme. So compared to the non-allosteric enzymes that just have a hyperbola because they only have one subunit in them. Alright, if we move to the next thing, what is feedback inhibition? Feedback inhibition is a process by which the final product of a series of an enzyme catalyzed reaction to inhibit the first or the earlier step of the reaction. Like I said, I'm going to be using this as my example, the ATKase. Now, the ATKase, what does it do? It catalyzes the condensation of aspartate and carbamoyl phosphate to form carbamoyl phosphate. Carbamoyl phosphate is the first product of this reaction. Now, this carbamoyl phosphate undergoes a series of other reactions, about three steps, to form the final product. So this is the final product. The final product is a nucleotide, cytidine triphosphate. Now, what does it happen? When this reaction keeps taking place, and at the point, the concentration of the CTP, cytidine triphosphate, gets so high, what does it do? It becomes the allosteric what? Inhibitor that goes to do what? Stop the reaction of ATKase. It goes there, tells the ATKase, stop. We have enough product until we exhaust it. What does it do? What it does is that the CTP goes to bind on the regulatory or the allosteric site of the aspartate transcarbamoylase or the ATKase, and thereby slowing down the reaction. So you find that the allosteric inhibition has an interesting way of regulating metabolism very, very efficiently, because they have more than one subunit where both either the activators or inhibitors and also the substrate will bind. So that takes us to a better way or graphical way of illustrating the generic feedback inhibition. So in a generic feedback inhibition, this is the original substrate or precursor, you can say it's a precursor. Now, this is a series of enzymes that have seven steps. Now, this is the final product. When there is so much high concentration of the final product, what happens? The final product does what? Goes back to inhibit an enzyme. This enzyme one, it tells, okay, you're going to stop. Then the reaction will slow down. So the feedback inhibition, the final product blocks an early reaction and shuts down the whole system. So this is exactly what happens. This is a typical generic way of, so if I ask you, what is feedback inhibition? If you can produce this thing for me, that shows exactly that you know what you're talking about. The cooperative behavior of allostric enzyme. Remember, we said it already, that the ATKase, of course, is the first reaction that catalyzes the concentration of both the aspartate and the carbamoyl phosphate to form the first product, the carbamoyl aspartate. Now, what happens? This graph shows a sigmoid curve. I've already explained this in the previous curve I showed you, but it's fine. So this, the sigmoid curve describes the allostric behavior, which is this. This is the sigmoid curve, the velocity of the reaction of the speed against the concentration of the substrate. Now, like I said earlier in that graph too, if the presence of inhibitor shift this to the right. Now, what that simply means is that you have too many concentration of the substrate and the enzyme is free. So you're reducing the binding of affinity of that enzyme, it then moves it to the right. Again, addition of an activator, what does it do? It moves this to the left. What it's telling is that it is having most of the substrate bind to the enzyme, and in that case, increasing the rate of an enzyme catalyzed reaction. So there are different types of allosteric inhibition we need to talk about. So because remember again, the allosteric protein will exist in different forms, multiple forms in the quaternary structure. Remember, these modifications in the structure of these allosteric enzymes or allosteric proteins only happens at the quaternary level. At the quaternary level. Remember, we said for quaternary proteins, remember again, for quaternary structure only exists in those proteins that have more than one subunit. So that is exactly our interest in this place. So this change in behavior of the shape or conformation is only responsible at the quaternary level of the protein structure. So an allosteric effector is any substance. It can be an inhibitor or an activator that binds the allosteric enzyme and affects its activity by changing the conformations of the various subunits involved. Now, it could be a homotropic or a heterotropic effect. A homotropic effect is that the allosteric effect is an allosteric effect that occurs when several identical molecules, now in this case, several identical molecules are bound to the protein. And a good example is just one molecule bind, example, binding of the CTP to the ATKase is a good one. However, the opposite is heterotropic, is when this effect occurs when different substances bound. Now, some substances will have like 1, 2, 3 activators or inhibitors binding in different subunits, depending on the number of subunits in that protein. A good example again would be if ATKase is being bound by CTP and is being activated by ATP. ATP is a very good allosteric activator of CTP. So that is a good example of a heterotropic effect. So now we're going to be looking at two models that tend to explain the regulation or what we call the inhibition or activation of allosteric enzymes. Now, this was proposed by three people, Monu, Dwyer, and Chengis in 1965. Now, their description of allosteric activity is that the conformation of all subunits change in this model, the conservative model, the conformations of all the subunits change simultaneously. Now, see what is happening. It is the conformation change simultaneously. What it means is that if an inhibitor binds to or an activator binds to one allosteric site, it will cause a simultaneous change in the other one immediately. So they propose that proteins usually have two conformations. Those two conformations are the first, the arrow state. R means the relaxed conformation. Now, in this relaxed conformation is the active conformation of the enzyme. This is the active or relaxed conformation, and this is what the substrate wants to bind. And the moment the substrate binds, you expect the formation of a enzyme-substrate complex, which is now dissociated to give you the product. Now, there is the inactive state. The inactive state is the tight or the taut state. Now, it does not have a lot of affinity to what? To the enzyme. Sorry, to the substrate. The tight state of the enzyme does not bind less to the substrate and more to what? The inhibitor. Because if it's in that state, no reaction is going to take place. So in the absence of substrate, most enzyme molecules will exist in the T state. Now, the presence of substrate will shift an disequilibrium. Now, there's an equilibrium between the T, now, so this is the T, and the R. So what it simply means is that the binding of substrate will shift the equilibrium towards this way, whereas the binding of inhibitor I will shift the equilibrium towards the T or the tau state. In changing form from T to R and vice versa, all subunit will change. However, one most important thing we need to know in this model is that the change is simultaneous the moment the substrate or the inhibitor or whatever bind, and that can be seen in this place. Now, so look at this now. This is the equilibrium between the R and the T. The L equilibrium is the ratio of the tight to the R. What it means is that when substrate binds, this equilibrium value L is going to be low because you're going to have more of what? R. But when you have most of the T, the equilibrium is going to be high. That's what I mean, because T, remember here, T is on top. That's exactly what I mean. So look at what happens here now. The bind, now, this is the R. The binding of the substrate will move equilibrium to this way. And what it means, if you convert more of this to this way, according to the Lechotler's principle, this one will now be converted back to replace it. And then equilibrium will be shifted to this. And the curve, and this quotient, or this equilibrium value L, is going to be what? Decrease. However, if the inhibitor binds, and that is not shown, it's going to be shown in the next one, this R will be converted to T. And the moment it's converted to T, what it means, everything now will be converted, and this L value is going to be very, very high. And it's going to favor the T conformation. So here now is what substrate binding binds at this point. And effector, remember, it has other places where the effectors combine, and that will be shown in the next. Okay, let's look at this. Actually shows us both the substrate and inhibitor together. Now look at what happens here. Let's start from this stage. Now, if a substrate binds to this, and remember, this is the RO. If a substrate binds to the relaxed group, it converts this to this enzyme substrate conformation. What is the effect of removing this? Effect of removing this is that you are shifting the equilibrium. To replace the equilibrium is not going to shift this way, away from this. And the moment this one also goes to this one again, if an activator binds here again, remember, it moves this one again into enzyme activator substrate complex. And what it means, reducing the concentration of this. To replace this, this one is going to come to replace this, and this is going to come. And at the end of the day, all this is going to lead to the what? Increasing the RO state. And the RO state is what favors the promotion of the reaction, both by the enzyme and the substrate. However, what happens in the opposite end? If an inhibitor comes, remember the inhibitor, like I told you, the inhibitor has affinity for the T state, because that is the state that will never form any positive reaction. Now, if the inhibitor binds to this TO, it converts this TO to this. If it does that, what does it do? It reduces the concentration of TO according to what? The Lechotler's principle. To replace TO, the RO will come this way. What that simply means, equilibrium will now be shifted to the right, towards this way. And in that process, the ratio of, remember what we said, this ratio where you have the T over R is going to really be high because it is favoring the T state. This is just a very good pictorial representation of the concerted model of cooperative binding. What about the opposite one, the sequential binding model? This binding model favors I'll put it this way. The binding of substrate here induces a conformational change from T to R form, just like we said in the other one. However, in this case, the enzyme does that sequentially. What that simply means is that the enzyme has to wait, the substrate needs to bind. The moment the substrate binds, first, it will now bring about conformation in its own binding site. Afterward, it will induce a conformation in the binding site of the activator. Then the activator is going to bind. And then, if they're going to, that effect will also, now remember, when a substrate binds and it is causing, promoting the site for the allosteric activator to bind, it is also going to do what? Deactivate or make the site for the inhibitor binding not to be very active. Now, what matters in this model is that everything is happening sequentially. So allosteric inhibition occurs by induced, that was the word I wanted to use earlier, by induced fit model. Remember, we talked about the induced fit mechanism. Now, so what is the unique feature? The unique feature is that there is negative cooperativity. Cooperative effect, remember, is whereby a binding of the first ligand of an enzyme. We said this, I've said it, I'll keep saying it, because it's important for us to get these vocabularies in into our systems. So I said the cooperative effect is whereby the binding of the first ligand to an enzyme causes the affinity of the next ligand to lower. That's exactly the kind of thing expounded by the sequential model. Okay, let's see the sequential model in action. You see, this is the sequential model now. We're going to start with a substrate. Remember, this is sequential. What it means is that the first step needs to happen. It goes to the second. From the second, it goes to the third. That's what we mean by sequential. Now, this is the T state. Remember, every enzyme without the substrate occurs in the T state because it is relaxing. No, let me know, because let me not say relaxing now, because the other state is arrow state. T state means the enzyme doesn't want to interact with anybody. It is completely isolated. Now, if the substrate binds, look at what happens here. The substrate binds, this is the substrate active site where it bound. The substrate will now induce a conformational change in this point. At this point, it's going to induce a conformational change. Let's look at it now. This, so it has bound now. First of all, there's a conformational change on its own side. Look at it. This looks like a curve here. It becomes like a little bit more curve. It's cornered here. Now, it changes its own conformational state around its own binding site. The next one, it will change the conformational state around this whole group, around the T state. Look at it. The whole T state now becomes half of it to be converted to the arrow state, which is the active state. And then it now induces another conformational state on T, on this side, around this subunit. Now, if it does that again, what happens? All these subunits now will change again to look like this. So at the end of the day, you found that, look at, it bound here, it changed the shape here, look at the shape here, change it, change again to the active state. You now induce this change here, and everything around this side changes. And in that changing too, it converts it. So this becomes R, or an enzyme that is now ready to go into catalysis. So, and these things are happening sequentially. So we can say one, we can say two, we can say three, just like I told you earlier. So it's happening in sequence. This is the opposite of what happens when the what? When the inhibitor binds. Now, if the inhibitor binds again, and the inhibitor is a case of negative cooperativity, what does it do? It binds the T state, right? It induces a change. Look at what happens here now. It induces a change in its own self. Now, you see, this now changes. And then it now induces another conformational change around this place. And then, look at what happened. This now, you see this one changes. This one now changes to this. And it induces another conformational state completely. This now changes to this. And this particular conformation will have lower affinity for any substrate. So this is again what we call the sequential state. So here the conformational change happens in sequence. From when the enzyme binds to this active site, it changes it. Changes the other conformation, converts it to the arrow group, changes the other conformation where the inhibitor may want to bind, but then make sure it changes in such a way that the inhibitor cannot bind there. So this is what we call the sequential model. Now, phosphorylation, or what we call covalent modification. You see, side chain of three polar amino acids, this amino acid that, polar amino acid that contains the OH group, each of them contain the OH group. Their side chain can be phosphorylated. Now, this phosphorylation is actually takes place because a phosphate group is esterified. Remember, a phosphate group is esterified to any of those bonds to form a phosphoester bond. Now, that type of bond is a covalent bond. And when such a thing happens, that is very interesting. What happens? When such thing happens, it forms a covalent bond. So so enzymes can also be controlled by the formation of covalent bond by addition of a phosphate group. That is what we call phosphorylation. So, and phosphorylation is really done by ATP. Phosphorylation by ATP can convert an inactive precursor. It can convert from an inactive precursor into an active one. It can be used again to either activate or inactivate an enzyme. Example is what happens in the transport across the membrane and in glycogen phosphorylase. I think this is another one that I'm going to talk about in the next few slides. Now the transport across the sodium potassium ATPase is a typical product of phosphorylation and dephosphorylation. But however, let's see how this happened. So this is serine. Remember, the structure of serine is you're going to have your this minus, you're going to have a hydrogen, you're going to have, of course, and you're going to have serine has just an alanine, you add an OH group to it. This is just what it is. So the rest of the protein has this. It is this guy that gets phosphorylated to this to form this. So this is becomes the rest of the protein, or you can say rest of the enzyme. This is the phosphorylated enzyme from part of the serine. It can also happen in threonine. Threonine, remember, threonine has another what? Threonine has another CH3 added from this point. That's threonine. So it can be phosphorylated as well. And remember, this is phosphodiester bond, and this is what? This is an ester bond. Just remember that. Now, I will say phosphoester bond is a phosphoester bond. It's not ordinary an ester bond. So this is a phosphoester bond. That's what they form. Again, tyrosine. Remember, tyrosine is an aromatic and alcoholic amino acid that has, it's just a phenylalanine that has an attachment. So this is, it has an OH group. This also can be phosphorylated. So this can happen in the side chain of different proteins or enzymes. Now let's take an example of the phosphorylation of sodium potassium ATPase bond. Look at what happens here. This is the free enzyme. The free enzyme is phosphorylated, and ATP adds one phosphate group from itself. Remember, ATP has three phosphate groups. It donates one to become ADP. ATP to ADP. So adenosine triphosphate to adenosine trisphosphate. One of those phosphates is now being transferred to the enzyme. Now, that means this enzyme has changed conformation. So at the addition of this, changes the conformation of this enzyme. And in that state, what happens? It transports three sodium ions from inside to outside because it has been phosphorylated. Now, remember in this case now, this covalent modification by phosphorylation is what induces this conformational change. And the induction of this conformation leads to the transport of three moles of sodium ions from inside of the cell to the outside of the cell. And the moment it does that, the enzyme finishes its job. Now, another enzyme, most times, is going to be a phosphatase. A phosphatase enzyme will now come and cleave out this phosphate group back and make this enzyme to remain free. Now the enzyme is free here, but the free enzyme will also do something. This free enzyme will undergo another conformational change because it doesn't have what? The phosphate. This conformational change it undergoes without the phosphate will now lead to another transportation. In this case, it will transport two moles of potassium ion from outside to the inside. So you see that to the right, phosphorylation induces the transport of sodium from inside to the outside. To this side, dephosphorylation or removal of phosphate leads to a conformational change that results what? To the transfer of two moles of potassium ion from outside to the inside. And that is a good example of how covalent modification is coupled to what happens to allosteric enzymes. Another good example we're going to be looking at here is glycogen phosphorylase. Glycogen phosphorylase is an important enzyme that is controlled by the enzyme glucagon. What is this job? The job of glycogen phosphorylase is to break down glycogen into glucose units, right? So when the body is starving and needs more glucose, what does it do? The store of glycogen will not be broken down by the glycogen phosphorylase and be converted into glucose 1 phosphate. And the glucose 1 phosphate will be summarized to glucose 6 phosphate, and that is going to enter metabolism. Yes, that's exactly what it does. That's the job. The job is to do this. Now, and it is controlled by, it is stimulated or activated by glucagon. Now, what does glucagon do? Glucagon is what does what? Gives a signal in covalent modification for glucagon is what stimulates the what? The phosphorylation, the covalent modification of glycogen. So glycogen exists in two states, both in the around it. Now, the T state of glycogen is glycogen phosphorylase A and glycogen phosphorylase, glycogen phosphorylase B and glycogen phosphorylase A. So in covalent modification, phosphate group is added two modes of phosphorus groups, either one on this side and one on this side, to convert from phosphorylase A, phosphorylase B inactive, the T state, to phosphorylate A inactive. So this is a covalent modification. So that is what happens. So glucagon triggers the phosphorylation, which is covalent modification. However, it doesn't end there. Now, remember, on this part, if you look at what I draw, this comes here, this side is covalent modification. If you go down this way, down here, it is allosteric inhibition. What happens? Now, allosterically, glycogen, glycogen phosphorylase can be inhibited. Look at what happens here now. You see, it can be inhibited by ATP, glucose 6 phosphate, glucose, and caffeine. What that means is that these guys will want to convert this glycogen to this inactive state. They don't want it to go to this, because the moment it goes to this state, this is the active arrow state. The only molecule that makes, that promotes the activation of phosphorylase B without the phosphate is AMP. So AMP activates glycogen phosphorylase B into glycogen phosphorylase B active. And on the other hand, if you look at these two, for phosphorylase A, which is the inactive, is also being what? Is also being inhibited by glucose and caffeine as well. So despite that this is phosphorylated, yes, this is the phosphorylated T state, but it need to be active to convert it to the what? The arrow state. However, glucagon and caffeine will also do what? Inhibit it from being converted to this state, so that it is going to remain in this active state. So what I'm trying to, the point, the most important point in this slide is that both covalent modification can be coupled with allosteric inhibition to produce a very efficient way for allosteric enzymes to modulate metabolism. Then we go to the next important mechanism, which is very, very interesting, the zymogens. Zymogens are inactive proteins that can be activated by specific hydrolysis. Zymogens happens when, you know, some enzymes in nature are so hydrolytic, they can be dangerous. Now, but when they are synthesized, what do? They are usually synthesized as inactive molecules. Those inactive molecules are what we call the zymogens. Now, a very good example we're going to use in seeing this is the chymotrypsinogen. You see, chymotrypsin is a peptide, is a protein enzyme. Is an enzyme that digests protein. Now, but how is this synthesized? Chymotrypsinogen is synthesized first. So if you see, you remove the nogen, now the nogen means zymogen, it becomes chymotrypsin. It is synthesized as chymotrypsinogen and stored in the pancreas. Now, chymotrypsinogen consists of 245 amino acid residues that are cross-linked by 5 disulfide lengths. Now, I'm going to show you a little bit of that before I come back to this. Now, look at what happens here. Now, initially, this is chymotrypsinogen, which is the inactive enzyme. This is the inactive enzyme that is produced. This is the inactive enzyme. Now, the gold colors represent the disulfide. It has 5 disulfide. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Now, this is the inactive enzyme. What happens next? The next thing is that an enzyme, already existing protein enzyme, the trypsin, now breaks or digests it further. First of all, cleaves a polypeptide bond from it at the N-terminal end to form what we call the pi chymotrypsin. That's the first step. Okay, it is better shown pictorially. Now, it is produced as 245 amino acid protein. Now, what happens is that the trypsin is the enzyme here, is acting as an enzyme. It will come and digest, it will cleave arginine in amino acid number 15. So that's what it does. And then here, what happens? Look at what happens here. From number 15, it breaks it down and it forms it. Remember, these two are still being held together by this disulfide bridge. However, it has broken the peptide bond here. Now, this new compound, which is still one particular protein, is called the pi chymotrypsin. But it is different from this, because here it is connected, but here it has been broken. It's only been held together here by the peptide bond. Again, now pi, remember this is the pi chymotrypsin. trypsin. The pycomotrypsin does what we call self-digestion. It now self-catalyzes itself to do two things. What does it do? It now cleaves two peptide bonds from here and another two peptide bonds from here. So what does it do? It cleaves, okay, from the right, what does it do? From the right, it cleaves what? Tyrosine 146. So this tyrosine 146 and 147 is being cleaved at that point, to produce a dipeptide that contains the threonine and what? Asparagine. And on the left side, what happens? It cleaves as what? At leucine 13 to release another dipeptide. Remember, these two peptides, so this is a dipeptide. Release another dipeptide, which it cleaves from carbon 13 here, from amino acid 13, to release another two, which is serine and arginine. The moment it releases, so it releases these two peptides from here, another two peptides from here, it now results to a new protein. That new protein or enzyme, which is a catalytically active enzyme, is now the alpha chymotrypsin. The alpha chymotrypsin, the active enzyme. Now you see that the alpha chymotrypsin is still being held together by what? By the two of the three disulfide bridges. So you see that this chain is held together by this disulfide bridge, and this chain is also held together by this disulfide bridge. And this is what goes on to now do the catalytic job. So this is the action of the activation of the zymogen, carbotrypsinogen to carbotrypsin. So I've already explained all this process again, but I can read my note as well. So the 15 unit, like I said, as well, we continue. The 15 unit polypeptide chain remains bound to what? The carbotrypsin by a single disulfide. I said this already. The pycarbotrypsin catalyzes the hydrolysis of two dipeptide fragments from both ends. Now, the alpha chymotrypsin now constitutes of three, remember, of three chains. Remember, here is only one chain. Here is two. Here is A. No, let me use. It is A, B, and C. And these changes are changes in their quaternary structure. So, the new chymotrypsin consists of three polypeptide bonds A, B, and C that are now joined together by two of the five original disulfide bonds. So now you see this. The changes in this primary structure that accompany the change from trimethyltrypsinogen to alpha trypsin results to a change in its tertiary structure. And again, alpha chymotrypsin is the enzymatically active because its tertiary structure changed, just as chymotrypsinogen is inactive because of its what? Its tertiary structure. And at this point, we've come to the end of this class. Thank you for listening and enjoy your day, and bye at this point.